This show is brought to you by Slice on Broadway, supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with the perfect pepperoni pizza, sliceonbroadway.com. And listeners like you, support this show at patreon.com/awesomecast. Hey everybody, it's the AwesomeCast, episode 310. I am Mike Sorg at Sorgatron on Twitter, here live in the Mayhem Studios in Pittsburgh, PA, in the wonderful Beach View neighborhood, rocking my Ecto Cooler as our delicious as our cohorts on the couch, rocking the Ecto Cooler. Because what is more awesome than some Ecto Cooler in your youth? So you're gonna hear some high C juice box sounds here throughout the show. I'm sure. But just a little
remember
fun thing.
Used to blow into the box and with yeah, it spit all the liquid all out.
I actually dumped it over here like on my desk and thankfully it all was contained because I forgot that I had actually opened it. So Capri Suns, never understood them.
They're just an evil trap.
But with us, of course, as I said, on the couch, it is John Chichilla from ChillaTech.net, gadget guru at Big Bank International Institute of Technology.
Worldwide.
Big Mac Daddy Bank.
Big Dak.
Say that three times for
that's
us.
What we call that now. And also with us of the Scare House in Aetna, PA, as well as there was something else. Sidekick Media Services, all kinds of fun social media stuff. There's something else you're part of that I wanted to mention, but I can't remember
now.
At Kate Dudders on the Twitter. Katie Dudas.
I'm worldwide.
Worldwide. Katie Dudas worldwide.
Extraordinaire.
Dudders worldwide.
And of course, I'm Mike Sorgas. I mentioned tech podcaster, et cetera, with Sorgatron Media. And so on. And this is your awesome cast. We talk tech geeky with people that are using it here in the Pittsburgh area in general. We have our awesome things a week and so much more. But you can check out everything at awesomecast.net. Subscribe to the show, audio and video formats, wherever you'd like to do it. Join us live here at live.sorgatronmedia.com. Now streaming on our YouTube channel. We used to do everything in one giant chunk over at the Sorgatron Media channel, but you just subscribe to the YouTube. Of an awesome cast is the actual username over there. Look up awesome cast, you'll find us. Or, of course, you can look over on the Facebook page as well. I'm hoping in the near future to go back to streaming on there, but I think we need a little more oomph in our hardware. We might be pushing the limits by doing like two streams and recording and doing the switching all in one place. So maybe if you could assist in that upgrade by joining our Patreon at patreon.com/awesomecast. Thank you to our good friends, Mike Fedor Show on Twitter and Thistle C Business Development up in Cranberry, PA. Both of them at the $5 level are executive producers on the show. They get all kinds of fun goodies. Thanks for that and supporting the show as they have been. So let's get into the awesome things of the week, which for most of us, it was going to ReplayFX this weekend at the David Lawrence Convention Center, which was a fantastic video game experience. Chilla, Katie, can you explain for the people what ReplayFX is?
It's video games and pinball as far as the eye can see.
Plus there was bounce houses, balloon artists, did you get to play the Street Fighter game that was like on the dance pad? There was
that was X Men. That was like the X Men versus X Men versus Capcom. That was pretty cool.
Yeah,
I did not play it, but I sat there and watched it for a while.
Then oh my gosh!
Did you play the game where it was like a stick where it had the pillars around you?
And I didn't get a chance to play that. No,
that looked pretty cool too. I feel like it was a return to your youth.
It was amazing.
It really was. So it was arcade games. Of course, the Pinball Association, which, Katie, you've had a hand talking with them on the Scare House podcast as well. So there was some serious pinball competition there. Then there were just rows of just console setup.
Yeah.
Now, My awesome thing was kind of getting my hands on some consoles that I've never touched before. As you guys know, I kind of collect these things. You've seen them kind of sitting around down here in the studio. I have more up in the office, not to mention a couple Xboxes hooked up to my main TV. But there's still things that I haven't got my hands on. And there were, for instance, there was a TurboGrafx-16. I don't think I've ever played a TurboGrafx-16. They had the Neo Geo CD. Not as cool probably as the Neo Geo, but still, like, I sat down with this game that was like some kind of Skyforce 2 or something like that. I don't even think that's the right name, but I played it for like an hour playing this thing. I just remember it was in Japanese. It was a top-down kind of shooter thing, and my pilot that I picked was a dolphin.
Yes.
So and also the Apple Pippin, I believe it was called, the like 1996 kind of like a 3DO almost. And I also played 3DO, which I don't think I played a 3DO before. It ran on PowerPC, like Max back in the day. Mm-hmm. It was put out partially by Bandai, I think, and in Japan and America. And it was like so low end. Like, I think I hardly heard of it before now. It's just that weird thing that I thought was like one of those weird unreleased kind of things. Mm-hmm. But they had one there with a really weird like pinball game that actually wasn't very good. Of all the pinball, and I sit down and do this small tiny pinball game, yeah, on the screen. But the biggest thing, the biggest awesome thing for me was the Super Nintendo CD they had on display. And I didn't even realize, because I've read the story, I've seen the Ben Heck videos, and it was a while ago and stuff, and I didn't realize until like I came back and talking with the one guy, I'm like, oh wait, these are the people that found it too. Like, this is exactly the one that I've been talking, like, that I've been reading about and watching and everything. Like, even when I went back with Chachi, And I told him, Riz and Chachi came later in the day, and I was like, hey, you guys, we got to go look at the Super Nintendo CD-ROM. And Chachi's like, you distract the guard. And by the way, there was a guard there. There was like security around this thing. And it was, mm-hmm, in a case. And he's like, you distract the guard and I'll run off with it. I'm like, you know, kind of joking and everything. And then we're talking to the guy that I think is the guy's father, that bought the lot that this thing just happened to be found in. And he's like, I can take it out of the case so you can take pictures. I was like, and I looked at Chachi, and I'm like, dude, you're not going to run off with this, are you?
Terry Diebold.
Yes. Death, yes. Yeah. But it's basically the Nintendo, Super Nintendo PlayStation. It was for the longest time, Sony's first foray into video games was going to be with Nintendo, much like you had the Sega CD kind of add on. And then you had one that was like, you know, both of them in one unit. It was kind of the same idea. And of course, Nintendo went off and did some stuff with CDI that pissed off Sony, and Sony went off and did the Sony PlayStation, and you know, utterly destroyed Nintendo in the long run. This was thought to be, you know, nobody's seen one for years. You know, all we'd seen is like kind of production things. Like, I still have the Nintendo Power that had different design mock-ups of what this thing could look like, and talking about it and talking about how CD-ROMs are going to be the next big thing. And there it was, 2016. I got to touch it. And I saw some other people. I didn't want to be so bold with it, but some people like got pictures like holding it and stuff. And I'm like, man, I should have done that. But I was just kind of like, I don't get starstruck anymore, like amongst wrestlers or anything, or artists or anything like that. But I was over this in the long run, because it was just like, this is like a insane. This is like Indiana Jones and the artifact. You know what I mean? It belongs in a museum, and playing Super Mario Brothers so I can play it. Which is kind of what this event seemed to be. I don't. Did you guys go over and look at it? Did you know it was over there?
I did go over and look at it. I knew it was over there from your pictures that you posted. Mm-hmm. That's actually how I knew it was over there. That was big for me. I saw a couple people. There was one table where they were selling like old NES, like a new NES cart that they made.
So it was. I was unclear on exactly what that was. So it was running on a Mac in an emulator, but they said it was like a homebrew title. But they made it to like Super Nintendo specs, and talking with the guy, like the CD drive basically doesn't work in this thing, but it's very standard. And he said they're going to get one from another drive and put the new diode in or something like that. And he wants to burn into a disc and see if it boots up, like is kind of his next project, mm-hmm, for this thing. So yeah, it was, they were like, oh, it was one of the few things running on this kind of hardware and everything was emulator. And it was a cool kind of game, but it was something that was designed. Cause they actually, in the story of the game, like it was talking about like Sony and Nintendo and it was breaking the prototype out and everything like that. So that was interesting that they were kind of partnering up on that as well.
What games did you play for TurboGrafx? I was a big TurboGrafx fan back then.
All they had was, again, another kind of... Oh, I took a picture.
Did they have Splatterhouse? I took a picture.
No. This is the sad thing. Was like, there's one TurboGrafx 16, had a game called Blazing Lasers. I took a picture of the cartridge so I could remember what the name was. Because obviously I don't remember what the Neo Geo game was, and actually there's the dolphin from the Neo Geo game that I played. Maybe somebody can remind me what the heck that is. It was Blazing Lasers, and it was one console with one game in there. I don't think it was basically each console had a game, and that was basically it, right? And of course there was like, I don't know, 30 Genesis, Sega Genesis with a bunch of different games, like GameCubes and, a few Dreamcasts and stuff like that. So it's still like, I got my hands on it, and that was kind of cool. And I played like, emulators of TurboGrafx, but to actually get it in your hands after seeing it in like GamePro magazines for all those years, and like, man, I want to get that console and that game and everything. That looks cool in my magazine, right? Or back when GamePro had the TV show. Like early on Saturday morning is when I got to like actually see what it looks like on a screen. There wasn't much for that over there. And it was over in that corner, kind of over by the Super Nintendo too. Like this was like the mysterious corner. I was happy to see Sega Saturns represented there with a few games that I actually hadn't played before. They were not very good though. And a couple of Dreamcast games I hadn't played before, like Ready to Rumble, Mr. Bones for the Sega Saturn. I'm glad I avoided that one when I was picking up old Saturn games before. It was cool.
I was surprised to see some of like the different makes and models and mimics of the Nintendos that they had to be able to then support all the Nintendos that they had running different games. Like RC Pro-Am was in like an upright system that played multiple different kind of cartridges.
Right.
They had some originals. I actually went through, I had the first Nintendo that you slid the cartridge in and pushed it down. And then I actually had the NES that came out and had the top.
Whoa. Yeah, the yeah. Top down. Well, one. There's these new ones, the retro arcades, I think is what you're talking about, right? Mm-hmm. I saw a bunch of them there, and there's ones you can get that will run, Super Nintendo. Sometimes there's a Genesis one as well, and they're because I think officially the patents have expired, so anybody can make these now.
Right.
So
even they say that the copyrights on the ROMs have expired, so a lot of the cartridges. The ROMs for the cartridges are actually legal.
So emulation is fine now for a lot of that older stuff, which is good because then you have, like, I know there's, I've seen websites of abandonware for like DOS abandonware. You can download old DOS games, throw it in a DOS box emulator and play them for the most part. And they're just like, well, there's no publisher that's defending this or putting this out. So here's just a big repository. Just like you go and download ROMs for emulators, you go and do this as well. So again, it's that weird gray area, but in the for the sake of preservation. And then you have things like archive.org, where they have in-browser emulators now of a lot of these old consoles. You can sit there on archive.org and just look up old video games and play them on your computer now. For everything from, like, I think Atari through like Sega Genesis and on, maybe. Some old arcade games, a lot of fun stuff like that. So, but no, it was really cool. I went into this skeptical that I'm like, well, am I really going to play console games? Is that really that exciting? Because I'm like, I have a lot of games. I've played a lot of the consoles over the years, but I was surprised how much time I did spend in the console section of this thing. Like really, just getting my hands on some other stuff or maybe a couple things that maybe I don't have, but I played one or two times. Like first thing I found set up was like Super WrestleMania on the Genesis. So I'm like, yep, we're doing this. So it was really cool. And if you're on the video, you can see the images from up above. Actually, that's towards like that like far third is all console games over there. And they had like bounce houses and everything and wacky inflatable tube guys. And of course, just so many video games and pinball and just, it was an awesome, awesome setup. Competitions happening on that stage over there with Donkey Kong. Like Billy Mitchell from King of Kong was hanging out over there playing when we were hanging on Friday night.
Did anyone get to see the blindfolded Miss Pac-Man tournament? I read about it online, and then I didn't see, I couldn't figure out where it was at.
I found the setup, but I wasn't entirely sure what was going on there, because it was just kind of like a bunch of weird boxes and people sitting around. So
what they were, from what I read, that what they were going to do was, it was teams of two. The player had to be blindfolded, and then they had a teammate that explained to them and talked them through Miss Pac-Man.
Mm-hmm.
That's awesome.
I thought it would be awesome to watch, but I couldn't figure out where to go. So yeah. I'm going to definitely try to get to that. I'm guessing this comes yearly, right?
Well, this is the second year, I believe, that they've done this to this capacity. And I'm definitely, this is an every year thing as far as I'm concerned.
Where do I sign up for next year?
Yeah, tickets on sale? Yeah. Clear my schedule. Nobody planned for that weekend, whenever is.
I wish I could have spent more time over there.
Now, you were involved. Of course, Scarehouse was representing there. So you got to be there. And I know you were playing with zombies and stormtroopers for a bit.
Yes, we beat the Simpsons game. Arcade game, which is pretty impressive.
With the zombies?
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Well, you know, zombies and arcade games.
I could cross that off my bucket list. Competing in the Simpsons game. It was very anticlimactic.
Did they have the... I saw the Ninja Turtles game. Did they have the X-Men?
They did. Over by the stage.
Was it by the stage? Okay.
It was by the stage. And by the way, there's an image of the zombies and the stormtroopers.
Yeah, the 501st was there.
501st?
Oh my gosh, I got to see Boba Fett. I geeked out.
Yes, you did.
I saw Boba Fett. I literally walked up. I was like, excuse me, Mr. Boba Fett. Can I take a picture with my zombies and you?
He was playing pinball when I saw him.
I saw a few stormtroopers on that Friday. And then our friend Ryan from Blood on the Leaves that we've talked to on the show, he was doing some man on the street interviews with them. And he's like, yeah, I'm trying to look for Darth Vader so we can get an interview with him. And I just looked behind him. I was like, you mean that Darth Vader over there that's walking in? And then, I don't know if you saw my picture of Darth Vader waiting for the elevator.
I did.
Yeah. The elevator. I'm sorry. But anyways, no, it was a lot of fun. So you guys have a few things that you thought were awesome from it. Just the event in general, I thought was just tremendous. Mm-hmm. And the guys went and covered it last year for Insert Coin to Begin, and I'm glad that I got to be, you know, get down there and check that out as well, and talk to a couple cool people, and hopefully we can get them on AwesomeCast in the near future. So what did you guys, you have some awesome things that you got from this.
I think one of the coolest things being there was being able to experience games and watching families experience games, like being able to say, oh, this is something I played when I was younger, when I was your age, you know, I wish I had more quarters so I could stay here and play it all. But, you know, when I was your age, we had to use quarters for this. There wasn't a place that allowed us to play free play like this. But I think it was fantastic to hear a lot of the stories from people I knew and people that I didn't know that would talk about the games and their experiences and where they played all the different games. And my favorite game there was, it's called Bishi Bachi. And I gave you a YouTube link because it's very hard to understand this game because it's all in Japanese. There's very little English in this game at all. There are very few of these that exist in the world that still work. The board in this particular game, there's a battery that's actually fused into the board, was meant to die after a certain period of time. And then once it was dead, it was dead. And then you're essentially of a game that was worthless. They actually reached out to somebody in Australia who they were able to find to fix this board. So they have one of just a handful of these actual working units in the original unit.
Wow.
In the world, which is fantastic. And I had heard rumors it's amazing. And I played it with a couple with my zombies. And it's a red, green, and blue kind of globe that you kind of smack for different games. And you would have to watch. They would give you the example. And you're like, okay, what's going on here? Okay, my hands, I have to do this. Or my hands, I have to, like, you. At one point, you saw in the video, there's a bride. The groom is, or the bride is running as fast as she can, and then you have to hit the button at the right time so she launches a pie into the...
See, that was the one that they were playing when we walked by it and just caught our attention.
It's crazy. Like, these games are so insane. But yeah, the bride one, essentially, she's throwing a pie into the pews of the church, and you're trying to see how far you can throw it. You throw gumballs into a guy's mouth. You have to catch them. It's just catching... the coordinating colors for sushi or a plane. It's goofy. It's just so fun and just like you had to be quick and just it was amazing. We just had such a blast. I was laughing so hard my stomach hurt.
It feels like that random like mini gameness of WarioWare.
Yes.
You know, very much. So, which I imagine there's a lot of games like this over there. Good news, though, because I'm looking at this video that you gave me, and it looks like there's like a sample of a PlayStation controller.
So maybe, well, there's a couple different meshed in that video.
Okay.
Like, there's a different vert, because I had looked and I was like, oh, there's a couple of games that weren't on there. So I think there are maybe newer versions. I think the one I played was from 2000.
See if we can find a,
play Bishi Bachi.
A home version of this for something.
And I have to admit that I have spent with Scarehouse a few trips down at the Papa Warehouse in Carnegie, where they house all these wonderful games. And I walked around, every time I walked around this replay, I saw something I didn't see before.
Mm-hmm.
Like, there was a game, what, huh? This is here?
The worst part was when you found something, I was like, I need to come back to that later. And you're like, where did I see that game?
Yeah.
I almost needed a map.
What row am I in? I thought those were over there, you know? There was a lot of that going on, too.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I found myself looping around being like, okay, I remember it was near this, or it was by this stand, or... it was by this bathroom.
Oh, that Stormtrooper moved. I don't know now anymore.
I know. You had like this one person. You're like, all right, they're there. If I come back and see them there, I'll find my game.
The one thing to what Dutters was saying, I was surprised to see the amount of families taking pictures around specific games.
Mm-hmm.
Like, not only was it like, hey, I remember playing this when I was a kid, but let's play it together. And then like they were getting a family picture taken around the game, which I thought was really, really cool. Just see everyone coming together, and everyone was so nice about the gameplay. I didn't feel like anyone was hogging a specific machine, or I will say that there were lines for certain machines, but I got my own, some Zaxxon in and some Joust.
Yes.
A couple of consoles, like they would have signs, you know, like this side of the machine doesn't work, or, you know, make sure you press this button to emulate coin inserts and that kind of thing. I played some Donkey Kong Jr. But I don't know. It was a pretty awesome time.
Did you guys see the Pinball Olympics aisles?
Yes.
They were in the back?
In the middle.
Yeah, okay.
The ones that were like, they were like viewers like embedded on them. So you can only see part of the thing. One was a Simpsons pinball machine that the tilt sensor they rigged to a helmet. And so you couldn't move your head or it would tilt the machine. There was a Dracula machine that I played where the bumper's right in the middle. Like the ones that you almost always hit. Cause like, am I really aiming when I hit these balls? I'm just trying to keep them out of the hole. Right. Every time you hit that bumper in the middle, tilt would get activated. And then there's just like kaleidoscopes and like Elvis Presley one. There's like a backwards binoculars looking down on the
there was one where you played from above. There was one where you played from above.
That was the Attack from Mars, I think.
Yeah.
It was.
Yeah, you had to get on steps behind the machine and the flipper buttons were up on the scoreboard and you played it looking down on the machine in reverse.
Right. They had a lot of fun twists on things. That was pretty fantastic. Tattoo Assassins, I think the one game was, which is like a really, really horrible Mortal Kombat.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I, you know, just reading kind of the description of everything going on was just seemed like it was just a lot of fun.
A lot of games from like my youth of like going on beach vacations and whatnot. Tubin was there. I saw Tubin. Yes.
Tubin.
The one that I didn't see was, did you ever play this? I think it was made by Sega and it was inside of a dome and it was like a hologram unit.
Oh, time something.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I played that once before. They had a couple of them, but you were like a cowboy.
Yeah. I didn't see that there. But I that was one I was looking for, because my favorite by far is Operation Wolf, and that's the one I probably spent a good hour.
I spent some good time with that in the arcade.
I have to laugh because I was texting our friend over at Papa, and I was like telling him about the podcast and that you guys were geeking out over the Nintendo CD Super Nintendo's prototype, and he said, "Sweet, you guys have to." I'll have to tell you about the prank that we were going to play involving the prototype. I said, that's horrible. He's like, Terry, the owner, and his son were in on it. I was like, oh my gosh, could you imagine?
just real quick, from the video here I'm showing. Well, first of all, Riz.
Oh, I love that game.
Riz and Chachi playing the rail car game, like that you had to pump and coordinate. It's and then we have a little bit of me just kind of yelling at them. And coaching them a little bit. Here's in a second here is Chachi playing the Simpsons game with the tilt sensor rigged to his helmet. hanging out in front of you. So it was a lot of fun.
It was one of the funniest things was I was so sore the next few days because I had used muscles I have not used in a long time. And it was funny because I was like, wow, my hand doesn't bend the same way as it used to when I was younger. And oh my gosh, the car game, there's so many games. If you could set up a gym with just these games, I would go to the gym more often. Because some of them, there was one, I don't know if you saw it, had two handles, and you were playing against each other, and you kind of had to slam them against each other and push each other off. That was solid.
It's so much.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I don't think I saw everything, even though I was there so much.
And Chilla, you mentioned Operation Wolf, something that I sunk a lot of quarters in. Myself, I got to play Revolution X, the Aerosmith game.
Yes.
And it's one of those, like, you never really put much time in, and it's one of those that you would have put a lot of quarters in order to make, you know, do something significant with it, mm-hmm. you know, and get very far in that thing. And it's cool to go to these things and everything's set on free play and you can just like hack away at that or play through Simpsons with some zombies or whatever the case may be, right?
Or the Journey game.
The Journey game. Oh, please.
What was the Journey game?
It literally, it's after the band Journey.
Okay.
And they have little teeny digital heads on their bodies. They're like little 8-bit heads and they're just different things, worlds you have to get them through. It's amazing.
Well, it's rough. It's absolutely
it's
rough.
It's terrible, but it's hilarious.
But
I was happy too to see a lot of the old school, I don't know what you would call them, tabletop type arcade games, like you would see it back in the day in Pizza Hut.
Mm-hmm.
So like I played Pac-Man and Zaxxon and all those. I remember going to, I think, like Hidden Valley or one of the ski areas, and they always had different mm-hmm. tabletop games like that.
I remember those from the you know, the bars back mm-hmm. in the, that I didn't end up with my mother back in the day. Like. You know, we go and she'd just give me the quarters and I would just, you know, go at whatever machine they had, mm-hmm. you know, there. And a lot of times it was like tabletop Pac-Man or something mm-hmm. like that. So at one point, Chachi saw one of the tabletops and some of them had for sale on them, like mm-hmm. especially some of the pinball machines and everything. And he comes up to me, he's like, I need an advance on about the next 25 wrestling shows. I'm like... Why? It was like you found a tabletop that was running multiple games. I don't know, it was some kind of one of those emulator machines or something like that. But it was like, yeah, you know what, man? Hey, let's eyeball that for whenever we make it and we have our own office and everything. That'll be in the waiting room, you know.
Well, and they had a section in the center where they were selling newer pinball type machines.
Yeah, there was a couple
of Did you see the Rob Zombie game?
No.
There's a Rob Zombie pinball game.
Really?
All kinds of swears.
I saw that there was Ghostbusters. I saw a Big Lebowski one.
Yeah, so the Game of Thrones.
But there was like a row of Hobbit ones that they had. And then there was like flyers say, hey, we are the official distributor of the Hobbit pinball game. I'm like, this is a whole other industry that I'm not even... Like all the pieces of pinball mm-hmm. that you saw in some of those vendor areas were just amazing. Or the ones that took like the marquees from arcade machines and put them in light boxes.
Mm-hmm.
Like I'm like, oh, I want that WrestleFest one so bad.
They're at Steel City Con all the time.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. That's something I'll be eyeballing. But no, it was a real cool. And again, you know, this comes around once a year, but I got to give a shout out because it reminds me of, because that experience I've had before with, of course, Victory Point, a barcade here in town was represented there. But Coin-Op Hall of Fame up around Aliquippa is this kind of experience, actually. And a lot of those games, a lot of those older games like that, and a lot of those weird old mechanical games as well. And I highly, highly recommend that if you can't wait till next year for ReplayFX, coinophof.com is the website for that if you want to check that out too. And actually planning to go there pretty soon for some fun stuff. So, and we talked to them on Awesome Chat as well when they were getting things going. So,
that's pretty much it.
Video games. Well, let's talk about pizza.
Ooh,
oh, that turned into a different ad, didn't it?
Yeah.
Slice on Broadway, our good friends here in Beachview.
Shame.
Right on the main drag here in Beachview. Supporting Pittsburgh podcasting with the perfect pepperoni pizza for a good while now, Rico and the guys up there, you know, of course, supporting our crew here, keeping them fed here. So, you know, I provided the Ecto cooler today, but it's over there. It's fine.
It's not working.
but they've been supporting the show for a while, feeding us. And you can check them out, like I said, here in Beachview, right along the tracks, as well as down in Carnegie, PA, down in Main Street, or at PNC Park, home of the Pittsburgh Pirates. Oh, somebody was just telling me the other day how they stopped down there and they got to check it out finally. Oh, our friends with the Renegade Wrestling Alliance, actually. They were down for, I think, a Pirates game. And they stopped in and checked it out finally after all this time. So visiting because they're not usually in Pittsburgh, you know, city area a lot. So they got to definitely check it out. So thank you, everybody that's been visiting our friends and let us know about it. And, of course, let them know. Slice at @PGH_Slice on Twitter or Slice on Broadway on Facebook and Instagram. I want to say Google Plus. That was a mistake. Tumblr, Slack, Plurk, you know, wherever. I'm sure they have all those. go check them out. SliceOnBroadway.com. Thanks a lot, guys. Chilla, you wanted to talk about some stuff that was announced with Samsung.
Some stuff was announced today at the Samsung Unpacked event.
Oh no! So was there dancing this time?
I didn't see any dancing. I didn't. YouTube's blocked it at Big Mac Daddy Bank. So
.com.net.
I didn't get to see the live feed, and no one posted pictures of dancing. There were some pretty cool graphics effects, and the stage was pretty nice for an Unpacked event hosted out of New York City. They were announcing, I'm going to miss items, but primarily they announced the Note 7, which is that there was no Note 6, so the next Galaxy Note device. They announced a new VR headset because the Note 7 has a USB-C port, so they need to adapt. There'll be a new revision of the goggles with a nicer touchpad on the side, supposedly more heat dispersion, wider range of view, and a couple other things. And then there was one other thing I thought they announced, and it's escaping me now. But let's concentrate anyway on the Note 7 to start. Much like the Note 5, it has a stylus. It's great. I will say that bar none, the Galaxy Note line and their stylus is light years beyond anyone else. The S Pen definitely has it done, other than, to me, the iPad Pros. And the only reason I say that, and it's not due to the device, it's primarily due to the shape, to me, of the stylus is flat and small and thin. And the one thing that I was surprised with, they talked about the stylus today, is they made the nib thinner, and they talked about the pen potentially, from the way they announced it, it sounded like it was smaller from a width perspective or diameter perspective. Hoping they were just talking about the nub, because they made it match a ballpoint pen. But the device itself picked up the camera from the S7. To me, one of the big things that would push me in this direction was it picked up the SD. They brought the SD card, removable SD card, back. It is waterproof, I think, up to 5 feet for a half an hour, and the pen is too. So if you need to take electronic notes underwater,
perfect.
This is your device.
That happens more often than you would know.
The cool, one of the cool features I thought, though, was they actually have a screen capture utility built in with the pen, and it's built into their video editor that allows you to quickly take and screen record and turn it immediately into a GIF, which I thought was pretty cool. Like, if you wanted to say, hey, look at this, it has an iris scanner, which they have admittedly said, depending on what kind of glasses you wear and what kind of coating is on it, mileage may vary, but they are already partnering with banks and they're opening it up as a standard. So other applications are going to be able to adhere to their iris scanner for unlock. And then they also announced that the Gear 360 is going on sale today. The one thing that I would like to see come of this, they did add some feature functionality with the new Note when it comes to the S Pen. Mm-hmm. Things like the GIF piece. You can tap on any word, and it will, if it's in a foreign language, it will quickly convert the language back to English. It does it one word at a time, which I thought was a little odd. And there's some other applications that they added in to handle the S Pen. They have stated that they're bundling more of the apps all into one app. So instead of having to constantly update or launch different apps, one app will handle a lot of these same feature functionalities. The one thing I am hoping, though, is that the Note 5 gets some of these updates. Things like grabbing an animated GIF, converting a quick clip of a video or screen recording to an animated GIF, I think is something that they could kind of make backwards compatible with prior Note versions. I'm guessing it's nothing super proprietary to
this device.
Do
they usually do that sort of thing, or is this kind of like one of those things where they kind of throw those kind of oddball features in just to kind of make you want the new one?
I've seen them go back with some of the things like the take when you take away your eyes from the device. If you have that turned on your device, they take your eyes away, it'll pause a video, or you can actually set the device that as your eyes move down the screen, it will automatically scroll web pages and whatnot. I have seen them go back and retrofit some software, because a lot of that is out of the Galaxy App Store. So they can update that app and make it backwards compatible. So I am hoping they do something along those lines.
Awesome. But I like this one headline. It's a $800 gift machine here. So, well, I didn't know the 360 camera was not out yet.
Still not in the United States.
Still not in the United States. You mean this guy couple. Here?
Yes, that one. Yeah.
This guy here?
That's top secret.
Yeah.
Is it?
No. Oops.
Oops. Well, we got some of the early tests in. But anyways, but yeah, so
are you a beta?
I'm a beta fish.
A beta fish. When Chilla lows, there's just a picture of a beta fish.
Yep.
Yep.
I'm like that beta fish from Pokemon.
The Magikarp?
No, there's another fish.
Oh, the Goldicarp?
Goldie
carp. Like
I'm crash coursing on all the Pokemon names
Pokemon
right now.
Pokemon fish.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. The guy's like, "Hey, there's one of these things over here." I'm like, "Cool."
Look at the options.
Yes, exactly. That's cool. All right. Yeah, Samsung. Geez, Samsung is like completely Appled on everything, and they're doing pretty fantastic. And that looks like another sexy looking phone.
They did get a couple digs on Apple around.
Of course.
The S Pen comes with the device. You don't have to buy it separately. Mm-hmm. And I can't, there was some other dig. I can't remember what they got in on them, but it was a pretty cool event. I'm interested to see that they're starting to talk about game packs featuring their new Vulkan API. I wonder what this will do. From a kind of splintering, you know, they always seem to kind of splinter Android and get some stuff that not everybody else gets. But we'll see. No one brought up the fact that this one can't, the S Pen can't be inserted the wrong way. I think they brought it up, but they definitely didn't.
I was going to ask about that too.
They also, and I'm interested, I'm hoping Apple and a lot of other companies, answer back to this. Galaxy Note 7 owners will get 15 gig of Samsung Cloud, which is also launching.
Okay, well, here's a question then. You've dealt with a little more Samsung services, right?
Mm-hmm.
Do you trust Samsung services more than Apple services? There's making a face for you guys on audio.
I can honestly say here, I don't have enough experience.
Okay.
I've purchased very little. I do. Their app store.
You're testing a lot.
I'm testing a lot.
Be honest. You're testing a lot from Big Back International Incorporated.
But even on the personal side, I'm testing. Like, I'm looking at their theme stores and I'm looking at their app stores. And I guess I feel like I trust them with my data, but anyone's liable to be hacked. So can you really trust everyone 100%? I don't feel like, the one thing I will say is when I look something up in their app store, it doesn't then appear in like an advertisement later on. You know what I mean? Whereas I feel like if I'm on my work computer, which is pretty locked down, and I look at some kind of backpack or bag and then I go home, I get an advertisement for that backpacker bag. And it's two different computers. I'm not signed into my personal Gmail account on the other. Obviously, they're running some kind of algorithm to calculate. I've never had that type of experience. So I do trust them from that perspective. But I think they're a little new to the game when it comes to like the cloud storage. The one thing I will say is, and then you may one day get to experience this, moving from one device to the next, they've changed the experiences over the years, but it's a pretty amazing experience. So when I went from the S6 to the Note 5, you literally took, when you started up the Note 5, it said, do you have another device? If you said yes, it said, okay, touch the two devices' backs together. It prompted you for your account that was logged in on the device that had everything, and then it just sucked all the data over NFC.
So is that how, so it's making that connection, but it's still bringing stuff just down over the internet, right?
No, because like photos and stuff
directly from the phone.
Yeah.
Okay, so it is different then, because like I booted up that Galaxy S6, and it was like, oh,
you can do that. You can do the Google Restore.
That's the Google Restore I did that brought in like everything from the Nexus, which I immediately started deleting because I'm like, I don't need all this crap. Misstep there. But anyways,
now the new way I've seen it done, and this is how I went from the Note 5 to the S7.
Mm-hmm.
They give you this weird dongle, and it's a USB. Like that would fit in the bottom of the phone, but then it's a USB adapter like you would have on the side of your computer that then sticks out of the bottom of the phone. And it tells you, do you want to transfer anything from another device? And it's supposed to work cross-platform. I haven't tried it cross-platform.
Wow.
But you plug that in, and then you plug in the USB cord from your other device into the bottom of it, and it authenticates. It prompts you for your...
That feels like the old, like, I can connect two Macs with a FireWire cord and do the same thing. Like, I feel that feels 10 years ago to me.
But it works.
Also, kind of feels like I want to play Tetris with my brother, so we connect it by cord, Game Boy to Game Boy.
But how many people do you see have problems going from one phone to their next, especially when it's like I'm on an LG device or a Nexus device and I'm going to this device? That's where I feel like it really helps bridge that gap.
Because there's still a giant miring of just incompatibility across phones on the same platform when it comes to Android, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, I got all this stuff, and I got all this awesome Samsung stuff, and you go to your LG, and you can't have any of it because it's the wrong name on the back of it, right?
Yes.
That's an issue. For sure. But that's Android. That's Android.
I thought Goldine. You were talking. Then I started thinking you were talking about the beta fish that played Pokemon.
No, not that.
And that was what I fell down that rabbit hole. I forgot about that fish.
Oh, I forgot about that. I forgot about that Twitch stuff in general.
Mm-hmm.
So, Katie.
Yes.
What's one of these stories you want to touch on here next?
Let's see. Oh, let's play a game. Our buddy Donald Trump was on Reddit doing an Ask Me Anything.
Oh, no.
So Hillary went on the Q&A site Quora. That's right. And so where are they going to next in their social media to try to take over? Let's reach the kids. Tour.
Snapchat? They're doing Snapchat?
Snapchats.
Because Hillary going to Snapchat with Trump.
Geofilters. They're Bitmojis. I had a conversation with discussing social media yesterday and how much more expensive Facebook ads are going to be this fall, because we're not only competing with businesses, we're competing with candidates.
Lovely.
Ooh. I mean, if you're not familiar with Facebook ads, you are competing against somebody else. You're essentially bidding. You throw X amount of dollars out. And
the word is that they're sorely undervalued. So get on them now while you can. That's what Gary Vaynerchuk says, at least. So, yeah. Spend a buck and get X amount is going to turn into spend a buck and get like a quarter of that in a few months, you're saying.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah, get on that train now, because you're going to be dealing with this. But I think it's interesting how the candidates are trying to jump in and find, how do we reach this audience we haven't reached yet? And I mean, man, if somebody can crack Reddit, they can totally let us know how to do it.
Well, this has been such a social media driven, like more than ever. Do you think it's more of a social media driven election cycle than we expected at this point? Or does it seem like, well, we kind of leapfrog every 4 years, aren't we, when the big election happens?
Yeah.
So maybe that's it. Maybe it's just like, oh wow, all this is happening online now.
Yeah, it's insane how much is just out there for everyone to see, and we're also burnt out already because it is everywhere. At one point, it was like with the elections coming up, oh, I only have to deal with the commercials on TV. I can deal with that. Now it's on my computer. It's on my phone. It's everywhere I look. It's an ad on my YouTube. It's just, you can't escape it, as opposed to before when it was like, okay, I don't have to deal with the thoughts right now. I can catch up with this later.
Right. And there's so many of us suppressing so many people on our Facebook feeds, for instance, right? Like, no.
Hide
them. Go away.
Hide them.
But I feel like the social media route is the most effective. Mm-hmm. I feel like you're going to have more people. When it comes to like the Nebraska effect, the Nebraska people are still on Facebook. Like, mm-hmm. when it comes to those social medias.
Chilla, you know I'm going to Nebraska next year.
I can't wait to hear about it.
It's good.
Oh, no.
I feel like it's the one thing that almost guarantees you viewers.
Yeah.
That at a minimum are going to scan by it. I feel like in today's world of Netflix and DVR recordings and whatnot, I feel like that's you don't know what you're getting for what you pay for, especially when it comes to advertising. I feel like the click-through rate and the purchase information and all that is way more measurable from social media than it is from a lot of the other advertisement platforms. So to me, it makes the most amount of sense.
It's the cost efficiency too. It's mm-hmm. the targeting and the different, because you can pick a specific platform and reach this particular audience.
Isn't that like what we were talking about? I mean, this has been the ongoing discussion because, like, you know, one of the things we think about is, okay, we're doing this kind of stuff, this media kind of thing, this online media thing. And we talk about with, you know, guys like Hulu's trying to stick out and compare, and they can't make as much as they do when on TV or radio or newspaper. And you know, those are the rates you argue against because it is so much more efficient. It's not the widespread, right? Mm-hmm. And you know, they're seeing that, you know, and they're trying to get more than just everybody. You know what? This has gotten too political. Everybody just take an ecto cooler break. Yeah, we've gone too deep down the rabbit hole.
But I think it counts for anything. I don't think it's just even politics.
Yeah.
Or,
no, yeah, that's just the part of it. And they just have just a giant flux of cash they'll be dumping into this thing over the next couple of months, like you've been saying.
Jerks.
So
hurting these small businesses. Do you hear that, politicians? You're going to hurt us small businesses because you're just going to dump money willy-nilly. Because they're going to target every audience out there, whether or not they want to be part of it or not.
Mm-hmm.
Jerks.
Well, on that note, let's bring it up with something else, anything else at that point. In better news, have you heard of the Gigafactory? Tesla's most important project. There's been actually some stuff coming up over the last week about that. Some images of it. I think they've got it. They're I think in the process of building it or have it going. I'm confusing it. You know what? It's my fault. I'm confusing it with the Hyperloop factory that's under construction, which makes that more of a realistic project, which was questionable for a little bit as well. But the Gigafactory is where basically our favorite mad scientist billionaire Elon Musk is going to be building his big factory. Actually, has built his big factory to make batteries more efficiently. Which is, as they were discussing on This Week in Tech, is a big chunk of that cost for like Teslas. I think they said like about $40,000 was the battery of that initial cost, and now they're down to about a $30,000 car for their latest iteration. That's going to be huge. And again, you know, it's the Henry Ford kind of thing where the raw materials go in one end and these batteries come out the other end. Mm-hmm. And there's a bit, you know, there's some robotics in there and everything. And this is going to be huge for this. And kind of associated with this, Solar City, which is a big, I saw ads for it everywhere when I was in California. Of course, it makes sense. And even there was some news about lately about them in Ohio and Western PA, I think. But they are, I think, merging with the battery side of Tesla, or I forget what that's called. And they're going to be working together on some stuff. I think it's going to be really cool for that. The battery technology, and you know, they unveiled, I think, late last year, this battery technology that we could put in our homes to capture energy, to maybe give energy rolled back to the electric companies, and really kind of make things a little more efficient in the long run. So it's not just cars. It's not just shooting rockets into space and making them land on boats.
It's not just tubes.
You know, and Chilla, I know you've been keeping an eye on this thing as well, right?
Yeah, and the battery technology was pretty cool. I think we did cover it on the show, and it was about a little bit thicker than the doors on your refrigerator, but it was about the same size, hung on your wall, and you could pump solar power into that, store it up, and then feed it back into your house or feed it back onto the grid. Putting things in motion like this for companies like Tesla is huge, because they do want to control the top to bottom integration points. They're taking, to me, a very Apple approach when it comes to this kind of thing. In fact, if you heard recently too, the camera that's in the self-driving cars, they have stopped using that manufacturer, and they're going to be building some of that in-house. I think it was also due to one of the recent accidents. Mm-hmm. With the automatic driving cars, but they are trying to get that top to bottom integration to give the perfect experience, but also be able to allow it to integrate more tightly.
It was really interesting. So I think I discussed before on the show, I had a chance to have lunch with a guy from Tesla.
Elon Musk.
No, not Elon Musk. No.
Yeah, whoa.
And when I say I had lunch with a guy from Tesla, it was at a picnic table at an event where we were both working or volunteering. It talked about how like initially when they had all those manufacturing problems, they hired a bunch of new people, right? Like they didn't want old car manufacturing mentality because it moves so slow, right? Mm-hmm. We've seen how many prototypes have you seen over the years, and how much of that do we actually see in our cars at this right. point until something like a Tesla? And they said, like, okay, we got all these new engineers, but they don't know how to scale manufacturing at this level. And they were having all these problems. So now they have a mix of those newer people, and they got some old, you know, the right old bigwigs that can do this and can actually move a little, like they're at least pushing things forward at the pace that they want to get this thing going. And I think that's probably part of it. Just to clarify, Tesla and SolarCity agreed to a $2.6 billion merger. So that's going to be happening. So I think that's going to be big. I think SolarCity might have been announced as an initial partner for the Tesla batteries as well. So think about that. That's SolarCity again is a deployment of solar technology is now merged with a car company / battery company, I guess you could say.
I saw Panasonic's involved with them. I don't know what their stake in it is, but they seem to be pretty gung-ho about all the technologies and partnering with them.
They got to be in on battery technology somewhere along the line, too, with all the stuff that they're into. So, Katie, tell me about the HoloLens.
We can buy one. Anyone can buy one. Who's got $3,000?
I don't know. I made this strike with the Google Glass some years ago. I don't know if it's my turn for this.
Chilla's
one.
Turn.
Chilla, this one's you. This one's all you.
I don't know. I don't have. Is it Mac, compatible with Mac?
Listen, you can support us on patreon.com/awesomecast.
Get Chilla a HoloLens.
Just Chilla.
You know, we can have a level. We can have a level where if you contribute at this level and we get a HoloLens, we will bring it to your house so you can try it out too.
And let you look at it.
Wait a minute. If you contribute at the $12,000 level, we will buy you a HoloLens.
Yes.
Along with the rest of us. And we'll all share in the experience.
Well, at the $12,000 level, you basically own the show.
And a HoloLens.
I basically sold you the show and a HoloLens. So at least one of those things is worthwhile. But anyways, but no, is this the SDK? Is this a, the, you know, what is this exactly?
I don't even know.
It's the HoloLens.
It's the developer edition.
Yeah, it's not anything, like, there's not a specific, yeah, it's just, you're still in that area. They just, it's like they just want to make money now.
It still is a development edition. Yeah, it says here in the article, but yeah. But I mean, it's more. This is not for you and me. This is for people developing.
Oh, it fits into mobile device management platforms, so your IT department can manage multiple HoloLens devices.
I think
I need one of these to test for work.
I think Chilla's working on a requisition plan.
Yes.
So I would. I mean, I would. Be really interested if anyone out there does get one of these. I would be really interested in just having 5 minutes with it, just to see.
5 minutes. It's all I need.
Is Looking for Group gonna get one of these? I mean,
I don't think initially, because there a lot of gaming application to this.
Minecraft.
Yeah. Minecraft.
Enough said.
There you
Enough
go.
Said. Yeah. Sold. Exactly. There was Minecraft set up on some of those consoles too. Yeah. At a replay, but no, maybe I don't know. They've just had to. I don't know if they have enough room, because they have all that. They need all that room for the Vive.
There was the Vive. Yeah. I took pictures of a little kid playing with the Vive at replay. Mm-hmm. He was adorable, and they had to keep like shuffling him into different areas, because he was just roaming off into nowhere land.
I was watching him too. He would be like way over there, and she's like just a little bit here, and he'd be like, "What?"
Please don't knock our stuff over. Yeah, that was great to watch. So, and of course, our friends Looking for Group were there as well. Mm-hmm. We're going back to ReplayFX, but it was cool to see the Extra Life people were representing too. So, which I know our friends have all been involved with in some form or another. So it's cool. All right. Well,
I wonder for some of the group, for some of the areas that are doing. Like, have high-end monitor configurations.
Mm-hmm.
Like, think about the break-even point. I'm thinking when these come out, we're not talking 3,000 a unit, right?
I'd hope not. But it is. You got to think it's a full computer.
Right.
This isn't.
You have to plug in.
What do you mean?
It has to plug into a computer.
Does it?
I'm 99% sure.
I thought the whole idea was the entire unit is running Windows 10. Like, the headset is running Windows 10 and is all-inclusive. That's what the verbiage has been before.
So the first one, it was hooked up to a computer. The second one,
well, of course the previous.
Yeah, I don't know. Well,
maybe this one's not final, and this one still does need to be hooked up.
Yeah, but even that, regardless, if you look at the concept of how much goes into a computer, well, let's just put it that way: a computer, and let's say you're a stock trader and you have 8 monitors. This device could actually be a cheaper alternative for some of those applications.
If that application exists.
But I mean, but a lot of people in the banking industry, like, they're set up, like even in security.
Mm-hmm.
Think about it from the perspective of all the security displays.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's not a cheap setup. So if
Keep
you could use this.
In mind, it's still a small viewing area, yeah. too.
And
so
I think that's something they're going to have to fix.
It's not like, and even you know, on the Samsung Gear VR, you still find yourself like, I don't have any peripheral vision. It's straight ahead. Mm-hmm. It's not as small as what the HoloLens supposedly is, but you still don't have like that side awareness. You can look around and you have that part of awareness, but you just don't have like, it's not completely natural. And, mm-hmm. and I don't recall that the Vive or the Oculus are much better with that. Like, I think the entire thing is like everything's straight ahead of you and you don't have that side, but it's not like a wraparound.
Yeah. But even if I'm looking at 6 monitors in front of me, I'm probably going to turn my head. I'm not going to.
True. But you got to make sure it's in view that you notice oh, that alert popped up over there. Right.
Well, that's when they can overlay the alert over the whole UI.
Oh, like my text messages that pop up in the middle of, geez, what was I doing the other night? I was playing some game on there, and it kept popping up something right in the middle, like where it, like the action area where I was playing like a dogfighting game, where you're like a gunner on you know in World War II, and it kept popping up in the middle of the guy I was trying to shoot at. And he was like, I don't care that I got an email, go away. That's a little bit of an issue, but I'm sure there's some settings for that I'm not catching it. But anyways, you think it's awkward and your mom calls in the middle of your Pokemon Go catching that rare Jigglypuff or something, right?
That's when you press ignore.
And the app crashes in where it's all over. Guys, it's been a blast. As always, talking awesome things, talking video games, sipping on the high C ecto coolers. Oh, jeez. Oh,
sorry.
It's all right. It's all right. He's going for the high C with a reckless abandon.
I'm out.
He's out.
Oh, no. Attack! Somewhere out there is cringing at that sound right now.
Good.
Sorry about that. Of course, please check us out. Oh, hey, shouts. I've been trying to do this for weeks, and I'm actually going to remember to do it. Hey, Pittsburgh City Paper has a best podcast category?
No.
That's what we've never been nominated for.
Congratulations.
Well, no. Our friends, Does This Hold Up? I had a bit of an exchange with them on Twitter today. But, you can actually submit.
Yeah, this is the submitting process.
So submit for our friends, Does This Hold Up? Or submit for your other favorite podcast, whatever that may be.
Us.
So that's open. Look for the, this is for the vote now for the Best of Pittsburgh 2016. I know we've retweeted them with this.
It ends tomorrow. get your votes in.
Get it in now, live people. And if you are checking this out on Wednesday morning, put that in there.
Okay, there it is.
Let's put it in there for you.
Hi, Krause.
He's just talking about randomness.
So go check that out. Support our friends. Type in all the podcasts that you listen to in Pittsburgh. Support Pittsburgh podcasting. It's good stuff. There's a lot of great shows actually coming out of Pittsburgh these days. Also, PodCamp Pittsburgh, August 13th and 14th. Katie is representing PodCamp with the T-shirt over there. There it is.
I was like,
We just see the 8. Actually, I saw the PodCamp in the corner, and I'm like, did I add another third under there? Because, like, on this shot over here, I'm like, what is that text when your laptop wasn't in a way? So that is coming up, PodCampPittsburgh.com. We'll be doing a panel discussion for podcasting and also a 360 and VR panel. And I think, Chilla, you said you were busy that day to talk about that. That's all right.
I will be at the ocean. Not just in VR.
Thank you for clarifying that. And I don't know if I talked about it last week, but our friend Riz was over on Ya Jagoff's podcast last week talking about Pokemon Go, yajagoff.com, to check that out. And that's wrestling related. We'll go ahead and move on from there. Anything else going on? You guys want to throw shouts out?
We're taking some friends to the regatta this weekend.
Ooh,
the regatta. Friends on...
Oh, that's this weekend. Uh-huh. I forgot about
got
that.
Got a regatta.
Darn it.
Got a regatta.
Taking a couple of my friends on a kayak. Well, two separate kayaks.
Can you kayak with a Formula One race boat in the river?
It was the anything that floats race.
Ah.
Yeah, I won't send you out there for that. Hi, guys. Good luck.
Go real paddle real fast.
Go.
I'll just swing down for some of that too. So go check that out. And of course, chillatech.net is the website.
That's where I can be found. And John Chilla on the Facebook and the LinkedIn, and Chilla on the Twitter, and Chilla579 on the Instagram. Mm-hmm. And
oh man. So much stuff.
Fiber optic on the Xbox One. And
what?
I think that's all.
Why have we not friended on Xbox? Not that I can do anything with my 360.
I'm friends with Chachi. Like he comes up on my screen all the time. Like he's playing this.
You know
he's
why?
Doing that.
You know why I'm going to end up buying an Xbox? I just got the Batman Killing Joke today, and I'm getting too many of these things because I buy the DVD Blu-ray digital combo and usually just watch the digital. Uh-huh. But there's so many features on the Blu-ray that I haven't watched for like the last year of stuff I've been buying. So I need a Blu-ray player. And I feel crappy just getting a Blu-ray player. I was like, well, I just get the console.
Well, then the black model, like the one that's not the S that just came out, mm-hmm. that's like down to like 200 or 250.
That might be okay for me by now. Mm-hmm. So, not that I really need more games to play.
Oh, but you get two free games a month.
Yeah, I've been clocking all those on the games for gold. So when I get my Xbox One, I have however many months they've been doing Xbox One games mm-hmm. are going to be sitting there waiting for me. I have not played Assassin's Creed Black Flag because I know I also technically own it for the Xbox One and I want to wait. That's where I'm at with stuff.
Yeah, definitely pick it up
if you can. And of course, I really got my video game in the last couple weeks between Pokemon Go and ReplayFX. So I'm good for a little bit, actually. We'll see this weekend. Katie Dudas, Scarehouse Podcast on your iTunes, and of course, Scarehouse Weekly on the Scarehouse YouTube and Facebook page.
Yep. Just recorded a new one today.
You were just on the River's Edge radio
mm-hmm.
with Brian there.
Yes.
Talking about politics?
Yes, I got pulled into that. I'm like,
Yep, heard some of that. Go check that out. Our friends at River's Edge, pgh.com. Oh, by the way, we are also there 8 a.m. on every Thursday morning after Funny Money. This show is replayed there. And, of course, our friends at Fishing Without Bait, also a part of that network as well. River's Edge, pgh.com. Some great stuff going on there with Brian and the gang. Straight out of Millville.
Word.
Throwing that out there. And of course, SorgatronMedia.com, a lot of stuff going on, including a behind-the-scenes video for Sawtooth Willie. That came out this week. Katie, I don't know if you remember how that went.
No, I didn't watch that yet. I have to watch it. I remember that. I didn't have a chance to watch it.
Yes, some very interesting things behind the scenes of how we put together people behind the characters at Sawtooth Willie. Go check that out at SorgatronMedia.com. You'll get links to the Facebook page and the YouTube, and just subscribe to those and check out all the back catalogs available. Those videos will probably make more sense that way. AwesomeCast.net, subscribe, all the things. Thank you to our awesome chat room. Yes, I've been keeping an eye out there. Although there's some links in there I didn't see from before. There are games for gold for August. Oh, I gotta get my games. I'm gonna see what that is in a moment. Thank you to our awesome chat room. You've been our awesome audience. Have an awesome week. This show is a member of the Sorgatron Media Podcast Network. Find out more at SorgatronMedia.com.